Welcome to the third section of fourth unit of molecular biology paper. The topic for today's presentation is post-transcriptional modification. So the post-transcriptional modification means, as the name clearly indicates, this reaction occurs after transcription. That's why it is called as post-transcriptional modification. So this diagram shows that the DNA is present, it gets transcribed to a primary transcript or a nascent RNA. These nascent RNA will undergo a processing known as RNA processing, through which you will get a functional mRNA, and this mRNA will convert it into a protein. So in this presentation we are going to see this part, how this primary transcript converted into a functional RNA. So this process is known as post-transcriptional modification. Okay. So this post-transcriptional modification occurs for different types of RNA. You can see this, the RNA might be snRNA, or this RNA might be rRNA, or it may be tRNA, or it may be mRNA, or it may be miRNA. So we might have all these different type of RNAs are formed during the transcription process. So once these RNAs are formed, how they are modified, how they are converted into the protein molecule, that is where different. All these processes, mostly the protein process will occur in the cytoplasm. But the transcription reactions are usually occurs in cytosol of the nucleus, nucleoplasm. These transcription processes usually occurs in nucleoplasm of a eukaryotic cell. Mostly this post-transcriptional modifications are found to be significant in eukaryotes. They are found to be less significant in prokaryotes, because prokaryotic mRNA doesn't undergo any modification. But both prokaryotic rRNA, both prokaryotic tRNA will undergo modifications. But only eukaryotic mRNA undergoes modifications. So these modifications are usually nothing but a capping reaction, or trailing reaction, or splicing reaction, and methylation reaction. So what we are going to see in this particular topic is the capping, say splicing, and the trailing reaction. Capping, splicing, trailing, and few methylation. So these are the four major events which will occur during this post-transcriptional modification process. Okay. So post-transcriptional modification usually can be condensed into these three steps: by the exo or endonucleotidic removal of the polynucleotide segment, or by appending nucleotide sequence to the 3' and 5' ends, or by modification of specific nucleotides. Three major class of RNA, that is miRNA, rRNA and tRNA, they are modified different ways in prokaryote as well as in eukaryotes. As I already told you, eukaryotic mRNA alone undergoes post-transcription modification. Prokaryotic mRNA does not undergo post-transcription modification, but both prokaryotic as well as eukaryotic mRNA undergoes, that is, both prokaryotic and eukaryotic rRNA and tRNA undergoes modifications. Okay, now we will see the modifications one by one. So as I told, in prokaryotes, most of the mRNA are going to be translated immediately after transcription. So there is no time gap for the post-transcriptional modification process. So there is no post-transcriptional modification with respect to prokaryotic mRNA, whereas eukaryotic mRNA undergoes modification reactions. There are four types of modifications are possible in the case of eukaryotic mRNA, and they are capping, tailing, splicing and methylation. So we will see first reaction. This is a cap. Usually caps are added to the head. Like that, whenever you write an RNA strand or DNA strand, we will write first 5'. So we will consider the 5' end like a head. So when you add any molecule to the head, it is called like a cap. So like that, this 7-methylguanosine residue, you can see this 7-methyl residue is added to the 7th nitrogen. So this is known as 7-methylguanosine residue. The 7-methyl guanosine residue is added to the 5' end of the RNA. That is known as capping. How it is added? Through a triphosphate link. This end is a 5' end, and the cap is also added to the 5' end. So the phosphodiester bond here is going to be a 5'5' phosphodiester bond. And we might have different types of cap structure. Cap 0, cap 1, cap 2. So if cap 0 means the nucleotides followed by this cap is not methylated, cap 0. If first residue is methylated, cap 1. If second residue is methylated, it is called cap 2. So that is how cap 1 and cap 2 molecules are produced. And this capping reaction is achieved by these steps. First, the nucleotide which is present at the 5' end loses its one of its phosphate residue. So it gets converted from triphosphate to diphosphate. Then GTP molecule is added to this triphosphate through a triphosphate link. Then the guanosine residue is methylated to form a 7-methyl guanosine residue as a cap 0 structure. Then if the other nucleotides are methylated, it becomes cap 1 and cap 2 structure. So this is how the capping reaction occurs. Actually, when this capping reaction occurs, the capping reaction occurs during the transcription itself. Okay, so when the RNA gets transcribed, during that reaction itself, the capping protein will be added to the 5' end and the cap is added. Okay, so this is how the 5' end of the RNA gets the gap. So this reaction occurs during the transcription itself. Not after the completion of the RNA, the capping occurs. It occurs along the transcription process. Okay. Then this slide shows the next process of tailing. So tail is added to the end. Which end? 3' end, because it's considered to be as a end of the RNA. So this tailing reaction can be simply explained in this diagram. For the capping, we need a 5' end. For tail, we need a 3' end. So in the 3' end, you need a two important sequence. One is known as AAU-AAA sequence, and then one GRU sequence. If these two sequences are present, it is recognized by a CPSF protein. And one more protein is CSTF protein. So the CSTF protein will recognize this GU region, and CPSF protein will recognize this A region. So once these two proteins are bound to it, then two more proteins, CF1 and CF2, will also bind to this region. And these CF1 and CF2 will actually cut the DNA. Okay, once it will cut the DNA, then another protein which is known as this PAP, polyadenylate polymerase, which will bind to it, and it will add the adenylate residue to the 3' end, which is created by the action of this PAP protein, polyadenylate polymerase protein. Okay, so this PAP, poly A polymerase, which will bind to it, then it will create a nick and it will start adding the nucleotides. Okay, so this nucleotide, once it is added to the 3' end, all the other residues or the proteins needed for this tailing reactions are released up. Then adenylate residues are added by this PAP protein. Once this adenylate residue is added up to 200 residues, then there is one more protein known as PAP B2 will bind to it, and then this PAP again continues the synthesis of an adenylate residue. After 200 nucleotides, again a PAP protein will bind to it. So like that, this PAP protein is added to prevent the damage of the 3' end of the nucleotide, mRNA. So the mRNA end is protected by the binding of these particular PAP proteins. Okay, so this is what is explained with these two diagrams also. You can see this, during the transcription itself, these proteins will bind to it and it will make a nick at the 3' end, and then it will add PAP and then PAP start adding the adenine residue. Once this adenine residue is added, the PAP binding protein will bind to it, and then it protects the 3' end of the RNA from the action of other enzymes. It increases the lifetime of the RNA. That is what the significance of this trailing. Okay. Then the third process, that is known as the splicing. How the splicing of RNA occurs? The splicing of RNA actually occurs nothing but the removal of exons from the intron. Okay, the intron is actually excised out of the RNA and the exons are joined during this splicing reaction. This reaction is actually carried out by the protein complex, which is known as spliceosome assembly. And these proteins are made up of this U1 and U2. They are called as SNPs, small nuclear proteins, because it contains both RNA as well as protein complex. SNPs, in short, they are called as SNPs, small nuclear ribonuclear protein. So SNPs is a short form of this protein. It will be like U1 and U2 recognizes the end region of this exon, and the other region of this exon is recognized by U2. You can see that AGGU sequence is required at the 5' end exon, and AGGU sequence is required in the 3' end exon. So, and then there is a cure sequence. In between these two exons, there is an intron. Within the intron, there is a sequence required for the recognition, is known as cure sequence. In that, the adenosine residue plays a vital role. So, U1 recognizes the 5' and exon, U2 recognizes the cure sequence which is present inside the intron, and they will bind to it. In addition to this two protein, U4, U5, U6 will also bind to it, and once these proteins are bind to it, then the nick is created. The nick is created at the 5' end by this U1 SNRPs, and then this guanosine residue is linked to the adenosine residue. You can see here, nick is created, and then the free end of this 5' or 3', two ends is created. No, you create here 5', 3', and one more 5' is created. This 5' end of this intron is linked to this adenosine residue. And then this 3' hydroxy group is actually linked to the other exon by the action of another RNA molecule which recognizes this region, the tRNA molecule which recognizes this end, will cut this particular end and it will join this exon to this exon. Okay, so this reaction is usually achieved by this U6 SNRNA. Okay, so after the addition of this exon to this exon, and then this intron is released as a structure of lariate. So this is how now the exon is joined with the exon and the intron is released on with the binding of this SNRNAs, U1, U2, U4, U5, U6. Okay, so these SNRNAs involved in the splicing reactions of mRNA. This splicing is known as spliceosome splicing reaction. Then the fourth event is methylation. So the methylation says about 0.1% of adenosine residues are methylated at N6 position. These methylations usually occurs in a sequence containing two RR. RR means what? It's a pyrimidine and purine. You can see this RR and X. Okay. So the sequence should have pyrimidine residues, and X means any nucleotide. Rarely it will be a guanosine. So pyrimidine, and then you should have adenosine residue and cytosine residue, and then any nucleotide, especially it may be rarely a guanosine residue. If it is present, in that the adenosine residue is methylated. Okay, so this is how this methylation is occurs. And sometime this prokaryotic mRNA will also undergo another type of modification, which is known as the RNA editing. So that means a single RNA might be processed in a different manner in different organs. For example, in liver, the apoprotein mRNA synthesized fully with the amino acids, complete amino acid esters. Whereas in the case of intestine, it's actually broken down as a half with about the number of amino acids is around only 2153 amino acid long is present in the case of intestine. But in the case of liver, you can see the number of amino acids is going to be 4563 amino acid long. So even the size is also very larger of apolipoprotein in the case of liver as well as in the case of intestine. You say apo48, apo100. So the 100 is a larger apoprotein and starter is the larger. So this is achieved only by means of editing the RNA molecules after this post-transcription modification. That is why it has a different name known as RNA editing. So through this process, the cytosine is actually converted into uracil. When cytosine is converted into uracil, it's become a stop codon. So the transcription of mRNA stops here itself. That's why the synthesis of the size of the polypeptide is short in the case of intestine, whereas it's longer in the case of liver. So this process is known as RNA editing. Then processing of prokaryotic rRNA. The prokaryotic rRNA is usually regulated by three important processes known as primary processing, secondary processing, and methylation process. Okay, so here the methylation reaction is usually requires a donor, which is nothing but S-adenosylmethionine. This is going to donate methyl group, and it is added to the adenine and as well as ribose residues during this methylation process of prokaryotic RNA. Okay, then here you can see the diagram. The primary transcript of rRNA contains three important RNA sequences. One is known as 6S rRNA sequence, 23S rRNA sequence, and 5S rRNA sequence. But it is flanked by certain regulatory regions, which are indicated by different colors. This yellow color regions are trimmed off by RNase 3, RNase P, RNAF, and RNAe proteins. Once this yellow color parts are trimmed off, it is known as primary processing, through which you are getting another transcripts, which are having some flanking regions, which are indicated purple color. And these regions are again trimmed by M16 RNAs, dRNAs, and M23 RNAs, M5 RNAs, and RNase-D. This RNase-D actually process the prokaryotic tRNA. This orange color part will indicate prokaryotic rRNA, and these prokaryotic RNAs are processed by the secondary processing. And we already know that these molecules can be further undergoes methylation process, and it will also regulate this prokaryotic rRNA. Then prokaryotic rRNA is processed as before, and eukaryotic rRNA is also processed by the process of methylation, primary processing, secondary processing, and it also has one more step as splicing. The methylation of eukaryotic rRNA occurs in 1-10 sites, and about 80% of this modification yields 2O methyl residues, and remainder will be contributed by N6N6 dimethyladenine and 2-methyl guanosine residues. So this is what the methyl residues are methylated during the eukaryotic rRNA process. Then we have primary processing and the secondary processing steps. Here you can say this eukaryotic rRNA, initially it has a size of 40S rRNA, and three rRNAs are present here. One is 18S rRNA part, 5.8S rRNA part, and 28S rRNA part. They undergo first methylation process and they are methylated. Here also you can see they are methylated, and then the size is reduced after this methylation process and by the primary processing. So the size is reduced as 41S. Then again the primary processing will cut this point, and it will produce two important fragments of RNA. One is 20S rRNA, another one is 30S rRNA. Then this 32S rRNA is again broken down by the secondary processing, and you will get 18S rRNA, 5.8S rRNA, and 28S rRNA. Then this 28S rRNA will again combine with this 5.8S rRNA here, and then if there is introns are present in this particular rRNA, which are removed by the splicing reaction. In eukaryotic rRNA, there are two types of splicing is possible. One is known as group 1 intron splicing, another one is known as group 2 intron splicing. Actually, this reaction occurs in mRNA. So, in rRNA, these two splicing reactions are favorable. Okay. So, in this group 1 splicing reaction, you can see that external guanosyl residues is added to this 5' section end. Then, FP, that is phosphate end of this 5' end is created, to which the guanosyl residues is added. Then, the 3' end of this exon is attached with this 5' end of another exon, and then this intron is released and exons are combined. So this is known as group 1 intron. So when guanosyl residues is involved, instead of guanosyl residue, we can use the adenosyl residue present within this intron structure. If that adenosyl residue is added to this 3' exon splicing part and then 5' end of intron fragment, then it is called as a group 2 splicing. So this adenosyl residue is attached with this 5' end of an intron. Again, it will form a lariat-like structure. Then this 3' end of the exon is attached with this 5' end of an exon. So exons are combined, and then intron is released as a lariat structure, like in the case of mRNA splicing reaction. So that is why it is called as group 2 intron splicing. So in rRNA, eukaryotic rRNA, either group 1 or group 2 splicing mechanisms are used. Again, these two mechanisms are represented in different structures here. And one more thing here, you can see that in these group 1 and group 2 intron splicing, there is no involvement of proteins. So, these reactions are carried out by RNA itself. That means the splicing reaction is carried out by RNA. So, RNA behaves like an enzyme. So, these RNA molecules which undergo self-splicing reactions are known as ribozymes. RNA with enzymatic catalytic activity. Enzyme-like catalytic activity is known as ribozymes. So, those RNA which will undergo self-splicing reactions are known as ribozymes. So, those RNA which will undergo group 1 and group 2 intron splicing reactions are called as ribozymes. And these reactions are known as self-splicing reactions. Again, this is one more comparison of prokaryotic rRNA processing as well as eukaryotic rRNA processing. So, you can see this 16S, 23S, 5S rRNAs are produced in prokaryotes. 18S, 5.8 and 28S are produced in eukaryotes. One rRNA is actually missing, that is 5S rRNA. Actually, this 5S rRNA is going to be produced during post-transcriptional modification of tRNA molecule. Okay, so during the transcription of post-transcriptional modification of tRNA, this 5S rRNA molecule is going to be produced. Okay, now we will go to the processing of tRNA molecule. So, the tRNA molecules are processed as shown in the diagram. So, the tRNA molecules will be produced with 5' flanking region and 3' flanking region and one more intron region. Then first, the 5' end is cut by RNase-P and then 3' end is cut by RNase-D. Then CCA residues is added to this 3' end. Then by splicing reaction, either by group 1 or group 2 intron splicing, the extra region of this loop is cut and you will get a mature tRNA molecule. And there is also one modification process known as base modification. It is a very important modification because of this modification you will get modified base like dihydrouracil, ribothymidine, okay, pseudouracil, T-cyclo, T is a thymidine, usually not present in RNA, but here it is present. Psi means pseudouracil. C means methylated residues will be formed. So, that is how T-cyclo arm, DHU arm, DHU loop, T-cyclo loop, anticodon loop, which recognizes the codons are known as the anticodon loop, are created. And then you can note that the 3' end of the tRNA will contain, all tRNA will contain the same sequence, CCA. It is helpful for the attachment of amino acid during the translation process by the action of enzyme amino acid, amino acyl tRNA synthetase. Okay, so this is how tRNA molecule is synthesized. This diagram represents how the introns of tRNA is spliced. You can see that the exon is broken down by both ends by the enzyme endonuclease. So you will get broken down of 3' and 5' end, whereas 3' end will contain 2'-3' cyclophosphate bond is formed at the 3' end of exon 1. And then in the case of exon 2, at the end of 5' hydroxyl group, a phosphate group is added. Then to this phosphate group, we are adding one more adenosine monophosphate. After the addition of this adenosine monophosphate, here you can see the cyclic phosphatase bond broken down, and then this hydroxyl group is linked with this phosphate by the action of the ligase enzyme, and then adenosine monophosphate is released. Then what is the significance of this AMP here? Because it provides energy for the formation of this phosphatase bond. Then what is the use of this phosphate here? This phosphate actually blocks the 2' hydroxyl group not involving in the phosphatase bond formation. Okay. So after this phosphatase bond is formed, the hydroxyl group is freed by the phosphotransferase enzyme, which removes the phosphate group, and that is how the exon 1 and exon 2 is joined and the intron is released and the splicing reaction occurs in the tRNA molecule. So that is how the tRNA molecules undergoes the modification, and the whole process of transcription is regulated by different inhibitors. The inhibitors can act by binding to DNA molecules which can inhibit the transcription process, or actinomycin D. Then other one is ethylene bromide. They can interact with DNA and they will inhibit the process of transcription. Then inhibitors can bind to RNA polymerase and inhibit transcription. The examples are, we know, rifampicin, which can bind to a prokaryotic or eukaryotic RNA polymerase. Rifampicin only inhibit bacterial, not the T-phage RNA polymerase or eukaryotic RNA polymerase. Okay, but there is another protein which is known as the amanitin, alpha amanitin. This will actually inhibit eukaryotic RNA polymerase. Especially this toxin will preferentially inhibit RNA polymerase too. And it has very less effect. At high concentration, it inhibits RNA polymerase 3. But it is not having any effect on RNA polymerase 1 or bacterial or mitochondrial chloroplast RNA polymerase. Which one? This alpha amanitin. So, alpha amanitin invention is a great use of transcription, because it only shows there are three different types of RNA polymerase are present in eukaryotes. So this amanitin inhibits effectively RNA polymerase 2, at high concentration it inhibits RNA polymerase 3, it not at all inhibits RNA polymerase 1 or prokaryotic RNA polymerases. When inhibitors can bind to this growing RNA chain and inhibits transcription, cordyceptin, it inhibits by binding to the newly formed 3' hydroxyl group. Because it lacks 3' hydroxyl group, so we can't add more nucleotides for transcription process. Then malic acid, novobenzene, dichlorobenzene can also inhibit transcription by inhibiting the synthesis of RNA. And the new inventions, new researches indicate that how the RNAs are transcribed. During the transcription of the RNA itself, the RNA is modified. These modifications are achieved by the identification of the new proteins called scaffold protein and the transcription modification protein. So you can see this aggregation factor and this scaffold protein holds all the process, all the proteins which are required for this post-transcription modification close to each other, so that they can easily modify the mRNAs or rRNAs or the tRNAs which are synthesized during the transcription process. And one more thing is that after the transcription over, the mRNA can form a condensed structure. This condensed structure make it possible, can be easily translated to cytoplasm. So this condensed structure can be explained here. The RNA, after it synthesized, it will have a cap, it will have a tail, and this tail is recognized by this poly A protein, and the cap is regulated by the CBC protein. In addition to these two proteins, we know there are much more proteins will bind to this RNA and it will condense this mRNA molecules. So that the mRNA molecule will form a particular conformation which will helpful for its transport outside the nucleus. So during this transport, few proteins are removed off. With few protein it is transported to nucleus. Then after it is transported to the cytoplasm, it is recognized by certain eukaryotic initiation, translation initiation factors, and which will bind to this mRNA molecule, which will promote its for translation process. Where you can see the CBC protein is released off, and then EAF4E will bind to this cap along with this EAF14G protein, and will combine both tail and cap in a single place. We will see how translation occurs in this mRNA during the translation process. Then one more important process for this particular post-translational modification is the methylation. Why we are talking much about this methylation? This methylation is helpful in many processing of regulation control of gene expressions. You can see that the methylation is maintained both in parent as well as in the daughter strand. Both strand is methylated in a similar pattern. The similar regions of parental as well as daughter strands are methylated. You can see here the methylation in the daughter strand. Here it is C is methylated. In the newly synthesized strand also C is methylated. Okay. So in the daughter strand as well as in parental strand, the methylation is going to be occurs in a similar pattern. The methylation is going to help for many cases. You can see here, even the methylation controls repair system. Even methylation controls the expression of gene. You can see here, the methylation is achieved by the action of the enzyme methylase. Okay, then the methylated sequences are recognized by other proteins like DNA methylated binding protein. They will bind to this methylated group. So the binding of these proteins to this methylated regions by this DNA methylase enzyme is helpful for the expression of this gene. And then one more RNA that is known as miRNA, which will otherwise called as interfering RNA, silencing RNA. When these miRNAs are expressed and it comes out of nucleus, it binds with some protein known as the dicer. Then it will process this RNA, and then it will bind with another protein known as the RIC. Then this RIC will remove the inhibitor part of this miRNA and it frees the miRNA. Now this functional miRNA, which is known as matured miRNA, will bind to its particular mRNA, which will prevent the expression of that mRNA. So that is how this miRNA inhibits the expression of mRNA. Okay. So miRNA means what? It's an interfering RNA. MicroRNA, or it's a mRNA interfering RNA. So it interferes with the mRNA or it inhibits the expression of mRNA. That's what it is otherwise known as a silencing RNA. So this is how we talk about post-transcriptional modification of both prokaryotic as well as eukaryotic RNAs. If you have any doubt, you can contact me through mail sivamayo@gmail.com or through 4986586168. With this books, we prepared this presentation, and with this I conclude the present topic of third section of fourth unit of molecular biology paper. Thank you. Thank you very much.